Sehr geehrter Herr Abgeordneter Gahler, sehr geehrter Präsident Hozer, liebe Frau Greiner, liebe Frau Gessler, liebe Kolleginnen und Kollegen vom Führungskolleg der Hessischen Landesregierung, meine sehr verehrten Damen und Herren. Ich möchte Sie herzlich im Namen der hessischen Ministerin für Bundes- und Europaangelegenheiten, Lucia Puttrich, zu unserer ersten Veranstaltung im Jahr 2017 begrüßen. Und darf Ihnen auch im Namen von Ministerin Puttrich, Europastaatssekretär Weinmeister und dem ganzen Team der Hessischen Landesvertretung ein gutes, glückliches, erfolgreiches und gesundes neues Jahr 2017 wünschen. Meine Damen und Herren, wir blicken mit großer Sorge in dieses neue Jahr. Ein Jahr, in dem die EU vor großen, vielleicht den größten Herausforderungen ihrer Geschichte steht. Jedenfalls hat es die Bundeskanzlerin bei ihrer Verleihung der Ehrendoktorwürde in Löwen so gesagt. Die Verhandlungen für einen harten Brexit werden beginnen, die Flüchtlingskrise wird uns weiter fordern, die Konflikte in Syrien und vor unserer Haustür in der Ukraine sind noch nicht gelöst, vielmehr wird dort weiter geschossen und gekämpft. Populistische Parteien könnten bei den Wahlen in den Niederlanden, Frankreich und Deutschland große Gewinne erzielen. Die Gefahr des Terrors ist noch nicht gebannt und Trumps America First kann eine Zeitenwende für Europa und die Welt bedeuten. Und dazu kommen noch die ureigenen Aufgaben der EU, wie Vorlage des mehrjährigen Finanzrahmens ab 2021 mit ersten Überlegungen für die Strukturfonds, die gemeinsame Agrarpolitik und die Forschungspolitik, Vollendung des digitalen Binnenmarktes, Umsetzung der Klimaziele des Pariser Abkommens, eine EU-Sicherheitsagenda, Einigung auf eine EU-Migrationspolitik, um nur einige wenige Punkte zu nennen. Viele sagen, 2017 wäre ein Schicksalsjahr der EU, und das 60 Jahre nach Unterzeichnung der römischen Verträge der Gründung der EU. Am 25. März 1957 haben die Staats- und Regierungschefs von Belgien, der Niederlande, von Luxemburg, Deutschland, Italien und Frankreich den Nivier-Vertrag und den Euratom-Vertrag, die römischen Verträge, in Rom unterzeichnet. Schon 1951 hatten sich diese sechs Staaten auf Initiative des französischen Außenministers Robert Schuman zur Montanunion zusammengeschlossen, um die für Kriegsführung wichtige Kohle- und Stahlindustrie einheitlichen Regelungen zu unterwerfen und Kriege zu verhindern. Meine Damen und Herren, wenn ich mir vor Augen führe, welchen Mut die Regierungen und die Politiker dieser sechs Länder aufbrachten, nur wenige Jahre nach der Katastrophe des Zweiten Weltkriegs den Aufbruch in ein gemeinsames Europa zu wagen, dann ist mir bei allen Sorgen nicht bange um die Zukunft der EU, dann bin ich optimistisch, dass die EU gestärkt aus dem Jahr 2017 hervorgehen kann. Und deshalb, meine Damen und Herren, wollen wir heute fröhlich in dieses Jahr starten. Und wie kann man das besser als mit Musik, mit Singen, präziser mit gemeinschaftlichem Singen und Chormusik? Chormusik und gemeinschaftliches Singen können in Europa auf eine lange Geschichte und Tradition zurückblicken und sind seit dem frühen Mittelalter ein elementarer Bestandteil der europäischen Musikkultur. Musik im Allgemeinen und Chormusik im Besonderen sind nicht nur eine Ausdrucksform der kulturellen Vielfalt in Europa, sondern auch ein wichtiges Element der europäischen Identitätsstiftung. Für mehr als 35 Millionen Bürger Europas ist gemeinschaftliches Singen fester Bestandteil ihrer Freizeitgestaltung. Allein in Hessen widmen sich rund 100.000 Menschen regelmäßig dem Chorgesang in ihrer Freizeit. Chor- und Gesanggruppen spielen also im alltäglichen Leben sehr vieler Menschen in Europa eine große Rolle. Sie unterstreichen auch den sozial verbindenden Charakter, der von gemeinschaftlichem Singen ausgehen kann. Frau Greiner wird uns dies bei der Vorstellung der Studie Singing Europe näher erläutern. Meine Damen und Herren, das Geheimnis eines guten Chores liegt in seiner Vielfalt. Unterschiedliche Menschen mit individuellen Fähigkeiten müssen zusammengeführt und möglichst so zur Geltung gebracht werden, dass die musikalischen Stärken des einen die Schwächen des anderen ausgleichen. Irgendwie ein bisschen wie Europa. Und dass das funktioniert, meine Damen und Herren, zeigt der Jugendchor der Monet La Coraline, der uns heute musikalisch durch den Abend begleitet. Dieser Chor kommt aus der Brüsseler Gemeinde Odergem und wurde 2001 nach dem Zusammenschluss der Jugendchöre von Namur sowie des Brüsseler Opernhaus Flamonet ins Leben gerufen. Seitdem hat sich La Coraline durch Konzertreisen im In- und Ausland einen Namen gemacht, der weit über die musikalische Fachwelt hinausreicht. Er ist zudem ein sehr gutes und vor allem erfolgreiches Beispiel für eine soziale Inklusionsfähigkeit von Jugendlichen. Meine Damen und Herren, ich danke ganz besonders der European Choral Association, Ihnen, Herr Präsident Hozer, und Ihnen, liebe Frau Greiner, sehr herzlich, dass wir heute diese gemeinsame Veranstaltung ausrichten können. Und Ihnen, liebe Frau Gessler, danke ich, dass Sie die Europäische Kommission heute Abend vertreten. Nun, meine Damen und Herren, übergebe ich das Wort an den Präsidenten der European Court Association, Herrn Gabor Mozer. Und ich danke für Ihre Aufmerksamkeit und wünsche uns einen schönen und vor allem fröhlichen Abend. Vielen Dank.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, please allow me to start by a very warm thank you to Mr. von Heusinger and the team of the representation of Hessen for welcoming and co-organizing this event here in Brussels. Our association is active all over Europe, but it was founded in Germany, and our general secretariat is located in Bonn. Moreover, 20% of European chorus singers are located in Germany, so we feel really at home here. Herzlichen Dank. Unfortunately, Mrs. Reichertz couldn't join us tonight, but we'll have the pleasure and privilege to have Mrs. Barbara Gessler with us, head of Unit for Creative Europe, the new culture program of the European Union, to discuss the impact of the Singing Europe report and the relevance of the data collection with her, and hear more from her about the priorities of Creative Europe. Thank you for accepting our invitation. It is now my privilege to welcome you on behalf of the European Choral Association Europa Cantat at this very special occasion. We are indeed delighted about having the opportunity to present choral singing in Europe, our network, and our large-scale Singing Europe study to important decision makers from all over Europe. Some years ago, I was invited to a choral symposium's roundtable discussion, and the organizers asked me to tell a story on how big the impact of choral music can be on one's life. Well, I did not have to dig very deep. It was enough to think through my own story. In 1995, I sang in the Monteverdi Choir of Budapest, and with this choir we decided to celebrate the 400th anniversary of the composer Claudio Monteverdi's visit to Hungary by organizing the first ever European festival of choirs bearing the name of Monteverdi. As a court musician, Monteverdi had joined Vincenzo Gonzaga, the Prince of Mantua, and his troops to reconquer the fortress of Esztergom on the Danube in 1596. So during the preparations, I instinctively joined the team and started to discover my organization skills. To make the story short, finally I became director of the festival and later the president of our choir, and I had to realize that I got deeply addicted to the joy of serving our singing community by these special means. So as the most important consequence, I discovered that the best way for me to help our community was to contribute by my organizational skills, even more than my singing skills. So indeed, the festival launched an irreversible personal process. It took me 6 other years to decide that I would fully engage myself in choral music. And in the end, I left our well-prospering family enterprise in the energy industry, and I started to learn cultural management so that I could start new music ventures and serve choral music at my best. Of course, this very special and personal example is quite extreme. Not everybody goes from an amateur singer to the board of a European association. But looking around myself, I'm always pleased to re-acknowledge how many friends' lives were positively affected by choral singing. Singing people consciously, or sometimes even unconsciously, contribute to the happiness and satisfaction of others. It has a very strong personal touch, and many times it creates ambassadors from people who thought they cannot even sing. Ladies and gentlemen, you will see and hear today that all people involved in collective singing, should it be singing, conducting, composing, or organizing, practice their passion with full heart and soul, invest an incredible amount of time and energy into a community activity. Choral people are delighted to meet and cooperate through a tangible personal experience, instead of dedicating only energy to empty consumerism. They prefer to build communities, care about each other, instead of ignoring other people. Well, collective singing is an art form that has always been actively part of Europe's history as a cultural space. and it has always helped bringing regions, nations, and cultural identities closer to each other. Collective singing is indeed very peculiar of Europe. It helps sustaining and strengthening communities, spreading traditions and opening culturally to others, highlighting the incredible diversity of European society. We believe that by enhancing on collective singing, we can strengthen and develop the European spirit at its best, and offer a powerful tool to build cooperations within the European Union and beyond, facilitating a spiritually and culturally connected Europe. Let me illustrate this with a short film. As you may know, since 1961, our association organizes every 3 years a major choral festival in a different European country. In 2015, the Europa Cantat Festival took place in Pécs, Hungary. About 5,000 singers from more than 50 countries all over the world gathered to sing, learn, and live together. Here are a few impressions of what can happen when the voices of Singing Europe come together. So, dear guests, or may I say, dear friends, the European Union was created to help the nations of the continent grow together in a peaceful environment. And this beautiful idea, ladies and gentlemen, is fully in line with the core objective of our association. Our dream is to bring people together to discover each other through singing and we strive to develop the adequate tools and events for that. And our professional objectives in terms of being a representative, efficient, and progressive network are also what the present and potential singing community and the European society expect from us. You will experience by our forthcoming presentation how many further benefits collective singing has on our society, how big potential it has in terms of education, social work, employment, healthcare, therapy, and how it can contribute at its level to preventing conflicts in our shared European space. Heartfelt thanks again to all of you for your kind interest. We really appreciate that you dedicated your time to attend our presentation and reception. If you like this evening, please dare to become ambassadors of collective singing and choral music, and please support our efforts to help sustain and develop Europe's singing spirit at its best. I'm almost done with my speech. We can now move on to the important points. Of course, the presentation of Singing Europe, that will be followed by a dialogue with Mrs. Barbara Gessler, head of the unit of Creative Europe at the Commission. But maybe even more important, now comes the time for music. We have the great pleasure to introduce the youth choir of La Monnaie, La Coraline, led by Benoît Giraud. Please give them a warm applause. Thank you very much.
Thank you. data collection on collective singing in Europe. We will present to you the reasons for designing this study. We will present the methods we used and the most interesting results we found. And we will tell you which perspectives this study opened for the future. Before going into details, however, we should explain what we mean when we talk about collective singing, because you probably have never heard this term before. We decided to use this term rather than choral music, which is more normal, or choirs, because it is more open, and it also includes more modern forms of group singing, such as vocal ensembles. Of course, in collective singing, we do not include families singing happy birthday or stadium crowds singing national anthems. We are considering people who are deliberately gathering to sing together in any form, but probably on a regular basis. And sometimes, even in our presentation, you will read terms like choirs or choral, and we still mean all the groups of singers together. The starting point of this pilot research project, Singing Europe, was a simple question, which was, how many choral singers are there in Europe? Or in other words, how many Europeans practice collective singing? This question was asked by the European Choral Association of Europa Cantat in 2012. Of course, we knew and we know our direct membership. We have about 60 national and regional choral organizations in 30 European countries, and lots of choirs and individuals across Europe and even beyond. So altogether, we have members in about 50 countries worldwide, and we know these members. However, we are not and should not be working only for our direct members. Our role is to serve the whole collective singing sector, including the members of our members and even those who may not be members of any organization at all. Thus, it seemed an apparently simple and very legitimate question for a representative organization or network as ours. Who are we representing? Who are we working for? And whom could we potentially reach? You may think that every network should be able to answer this question. However, even though it seemed simple, answering was a bit challenging because it's not so easy to count the people. So, if you talk in terms of data collection, how can we find the relevant data? Singers do not have to register anyway. So, let's say the European Hunters Association. They can pretty much rely on national figures because people have to ask for a hunting permit. So you only count the hunting permits and you know how many hunters there are in Europe. Choral singers are not required to register with authorities, luckily so. So it was going to get more complicated to gather the relevant figures at European level. That's probably true for any amateur arts or free time activity. The question was also challenging for us as a network. Many networks are actually afraid to do a data collection because they're afraid of what will be the result. Will the result meet our expectations? Will it show in the end that singing is only a niche activity that nobody practices in Europe? Wouldn't it be safer to avoid statistics and to just focus on the social importance of choral singing? Well, we decided, no, we would go for it. Why did we do it? Why was it important for our network? We wanted to improve the image of choral singing, of collective singing. It's a popular art form, but singers and choirs sometimes have the feeling that this is not recognized by others. So one aim was to do some fact-checking. Is collective singing mostly practiced by elderly people in dark churches? Or is it mostly school children across Europe singing unisono in little choirs? Or could the landscape be a bit more rich and diverse than most people think? Also, we wanted to be able to design relevant activities for our targets. So the organizers of European activities should have a better understanding of their natural market and of their expectations so they can adapt their programs and their offers. Finally, we felt that our role as a European network should also be to empower our sector. We felt that with a clearer vision of the realities, based on comparable data, our stakeholders would find it easier to enter into beneficial relations with other sectors, with fund givers, with the media, or with society at large. And we could maybe help them to find these data. Let us now have a look at the context in which we carried out the Singing Europe study. It was conducted in the frame of a project called VOICE, Vision on Innovation for Choral Music in Europe. It was a European cooperation project funded by the EU Culture Programme and gathering 15 partners from 11 European countries between 2012 and 2015. In 2016, this project was selected as a success story by the European Commission, and they made a movie about it, which was interesting for us because it didn't come from us, they chose from the material that we had provided. So let's look at this movie to give you the context of the study.
Run, son, not skip, falling at your mom. Meet sweet talk, newspaper, work at all.
There are 37 million choir singers in Europe. When people sing together, bonds are forged, people grow, and communities are built. This idea led choral societies from across Europe to join together in the VOICE project, the first ever large-scale choral music corporation project. Choral music is strongly traditional, often rooted in faith and culture, but it is also surprisingly innovative. Research and experiments are happening all the time, all over Europe, at a local and national level. The VOICE project launched in 2012. It was created in the belief that by encouraging innovative research, mobilizing young singers, and encouraging intercultural dialogue, choral singing across Europe could reach a whole new audience. Funding by Creative Europe helped the project to build on its successes. Over the next 3 years, the VOICE project worked with key partners to bring young singers from across Europe together and inspire them to collaborate. Activities range from festivals for amateurs and professionals to masterclasses and workshops. Scientific research programs and conferences also received funding. The project reached tens of thousands of people from 52 different countries in many ways. Audiences, participants, researchers, and volunteers all contributed to its success. Choral music events can be expensive and exclusive. European funding removed these barriers, bringing the art to a wider and younger audience. Music has always brought people together. Creative Europe is proud to help continue that tradition. The legacy of the VOICE project is a vast network of people and organizations all infused with a new vision of choral music's future as a European cultural movement.
What were the challenges of gathering data? So how did we overcome these challenges? Which methods did we choose? Over 2 years, with the help of a researcher, and I don't actually know if he's in the room, but it's Roman who worked for us and he was going to be here tonight, we gathered all the data we could find. We also had the help of the project partners, of our full network. We did some internet research, we used social media, and we worked on two different data sources. So first, we collected existing quantitative data. We looked at the national and regional level. We asked statistical institutes, universities, national organizations what was available. Then we created qualitative data. We disseminated an online questionnaire to choirs. We disseminated in 23 languages and gathered 5,000 usable answers from this questionnaire. And then we compiled, analyzed, and wrote, published, and disseminated a 160 pages report. We have a few copies back there if you want to take those 160 pages back home. Now, I would like to ask you a question. Before we look at the detailed results, let's try to do a little data collection here in the room. My mouse doesn't work anymore. We started our data collection with a Eurobarometer question. Some of you may be familiar with the Eurobarometer. Now, interestingly enough, this question was, have you sung in the last 12 months? So if I ask you this question, could you please raise your hand if you would say yes to the question, have you sung in the last 12 months? It's quite an impressive amount of hands. So this is wonderful news for our conductor for later. Now, of course, the point is that maybe you didn't sing in a choir. Maybe you raised your hand because you sang happy birthday for your grandchild, or you went to a karaoke bar and you sang along there. So if I ask the question in a different way, if I ask, did you sing in a choir during the last 12 months? How many people would raise their hands? Still not bad, actually, not bad at all. Thank you very much. And if I ask the question, are you a singer, who would answer with yes? So it's mostly the same people. That's nice to hear. It's interesting because these kind of questions also have cultural differences. When we compare the Eurobarometer to our own statistics, we realize that in some countries, the same people answered, I sang in the last 12 months, who also said they sang in a choir. But in some countries, of course, many more answered yes. It depends on how the translation of this question is perceived. So now, let's go to the figures. Obviously, the big figure is no longer a surprise. You've heard it a couple of times tonight. But anyway, we collected all this data. And just to be sure that we were on the right side, we also asked some institutes to do professional surveys for Italy, Slovenia, and Romania. We wanted to test our methodology and also think about the future extension of our pilot research. And in the case of Italy, for example, we compared this data collected by the institute to our own data and found that we were very near to each other in the results, so it confirmed that our method worked. The data at hand covered about 90% of the population of the European Union and around 60% of the European countries at large. That was the hard data that was available. And that brought us to the following figures, that if we look at the 37 million people, it's about 4.5% of the European population that is involved in collective singing activities. So it's the 37 million we have been talking about if we think about continental Europe, and it's over 22 million if we think about the European Union. Until this study, we had been estimating that there were about 20 million singers in Europe, so in continental Europe. So coming back to the question, were we afraid of the results? Yes, we were, but we were positively surprised because we had a sudden increase of 85% in the singers in Europe. So for our organization, we can say it was worthwhile to do this job because now we can use bigger figures than we did in the past. We were also able to draw a map, the first ever map of collective singing, and everybody could find his or her own country to see, oh, how many people sing in my country, and some people were rather surprised by this figure. You can also see that there are some differences between the countries, and I cannot go into details now, you will have to read the report to discover them, but some of them are obviously also connected to the historical development of collective singing in the respective country. We already heard that there are a lot of singers in Germany, there are a lot of singers in Hessen. Obviously, this also has some historical reasons. So we look at the European Union, because now we are here in Brussels. We're talking about 22.5 million singers in the European Union. Now, this is a very big and rather abstract figure. Can you visualize 22.5 million people? I can't, I must say. So my colleague and I, we started thinking, how can we help you to understand what this figure means? So, for example, if you accumulate, if you accumulate the populations of London, Berlin, Madrid, Rome, and Paris, you throw them all together into one choir, then you have 22.5 million singers. Pretty big choir. If you are more of a geographical person in distances, you can also try to make a chain of these singers, and they hold hands, and they would reach from the North Pole to the South Pole. so they would cover half our Earth. This is the figure that we found out. Now, what does this mean, this figure? The first conclusion we were able to draw as a result of this research was a simple one. When we compare singing with other free time activities, collective singing is certainly not a niche art form. So that was the first answer to a question we had asked ourselves before. It's a major cultural activity. Now, if I ask you, do you think more people sing in a choir, in a collective setting in Europe, or actively play soccer? Who thinks that more people play soccer in Europe? They don't dare to raise their hands anymore because they think if I ask, it's probably wrong. You would be surprised. Actually, if you are a German, you are right. Because in Germany, more people actively play soccer than sing, despite the big number of singers in Germany. So we are not only a strong singing country, we are also a strong soccer country. But if you look at the whole of Europe, you would be surprised there are more people singing in collective settings than playing soccer actively. We were surprised when we found this out. And then, of course, soccer players sometimes sing too, and some of them may be singing in the choir as well, so they may appear in both statistics. So there you see some singing soccer players. We were talking about that yesterday evening, about singing national anthems and how this has changed in Germany between my childhood and nowadays, about who sings the German national anthem. Now, who are these singers? And before I show what I have on my screen, the first question is, after hearing this choir, is it only women? No, it's not. There are also singing men. Germany, and especially actually Hessen and Rheinland-Pfalz, are regions where there are loads of male choirs, and the chair of our music commission, who happens to live in Hessen, Mr. Jan Schumacher, has conducted a few male choirs and is conducting male choirs, so yes, there are singing men. However, statistically speaking, the men are a clear minority in this field. And if you have to look at gender mainstreaming and choral singing, you have to support boys and men rather than girls and women. But the other question was, do we think that the singers are mostly elderly people? Which a lot of people seem to think. They think it's churchgoers, people with gray hair singing. But according to the available data, the situation is quite different. And we looked at different countries, and as you can already see from the lines, it's not the same in every country either. So if you look at a country like Germany, we have quite a lot of singers in their golden age, which does not mean that children and young people don't sing in Germany, but it just means that there are also a lot of people in their golden age. And I think it reflects the tradition of choral singing in Germany, because we have a very long tradition, so a lot of people started singing after the Second World War, and they're still singing, so they're not young anymore. Some of them say, I'm still young at heart. We actually have quite a lot of choirs in Germany who are over 100 years old as a choir. Obviously, the singers are not all over 100 years old, but the choir. And there is a system of medals to award these choirs in Germany, which is quite popular. Now, if you look at Slovenia as a comparison, you see that they have a much higher percentage in early adulthood period and much lower percentages in older singers. If you look at Italy, they have a very strong section in the active adult years, which in other countries is often difficult. So it would be interesting to find out how do Italians manage to get younger adults who have children and are working to sing, but obviously they do somehow manage. So you can see the diversity is quite big, and that's an important result of the Singing Europe study as well. It's not so easy to say what is choral singing in Europe, because the situation can be quite different in different countries. So we have to adapt our strategies also according to the target groups in the different countries and the different parts of society we may have to have offers for these different age groups that we have in the singing. There is one global trend, which is the higher level of practice among youth, because they usually have more time for extracurricular activities. However, only in some countries, collective singing is part of the regular school curriculum, and one of the model countries there is Estonia. You may have seen on television at some point the Estonian Song Celebration, where 25,000 Estonians sing together in one choir. They can do that on a high quality because they have all sung in school. I have never met a Slovenian who has not sung in a choir. I think this doesn't exist. An Estonian, sorry, yes. So that's the answer. Now, we asked a lot of questions and I cannot go into all of them. I would like to focus on one more question, which is, why do people sing? It was an interesting question for us, and obviously it did not appear in the quantitative studies, but it was part of our survey. So we were expecting, of course, to hear things like people want to spend their leisure time with something, they want to produce concerts, they want to reach a higher musical quality. But we were actually positively surprised by some findings that were related to social aims of the different singing ensembles. And over 90% of the people we asked want to contribute to the well-being of singers. So it's a very strong aim for choirs. It's why they meet and why they sing. As a singer, I would say the answer is probably because most of them feel better after a rehearsal. So that's why they are promoting this as well. But also 65% want to contribute to social integration of different generations or cultures. I think this is becoming very important nowadays in the situation we have with a lot of refugees in many countries, that singing together can help build bridges between cultures, but it can also help build bridges between different generations and other groups in society. And what was maybe the most surprising for us, almost 30% of the choirs want to contribute to the integration of disabled persons. And I just saw that right opposite here is the European Center for Disabled People, I think. So when I came in here, I saw that was interesting. Obviously, they don't all manage, so they may sometimes need help on how to do it, but they are open and they have this aim. So it shows that collective singing is already a force for change. But as I said, if you compare the expectations and the reality, it also shows that a lot of choirs still need support and tools to reach the aims they have set themselves. So these findings have led us to define a new strategy for the association and to create some specific European projects that go in this direction. So we have received an Erasmus Plus fund to do a project called Sing Mean, which is about how to bring people from the host country and migrants, including refugees, together through common singing. We also have a series called Hearts in Harmony events, which is about how to include people with disabilities in choirs. So it was an aim that came out of this study to say, okay, this is so important for the choirs, we should do something. And it was very nice for us to see that in a way the choirs confirmed what our president said at the beginning, they confirmed our belief that collective singing can be a very strong tool for all kinds of social aims, for the inclusion of people who are in danger of being included, excluded in all kinds of ways. So this is a strength of collective singing. Two more figures that may be just interesting. Collective singing is statistically speaking an amateur art form. Obviously young people like the choir we just heard are amateurs, but also most of the adult choirs are amateurs. 95% of the collective singers are not paid. They're actually usually paying to do what they want to do. So collective singing is an amateur activity. However, these amateurs are conducted and trained, taught by trained musicians, many of whom are also paid for their work, as you will see in a moment. Let's do a little calculation. If we round the figure and we say 22 million in the EU rehearse an average of 3 hours a week, and they have about 45 rehearsals a year, then we get to this very impressive figure of 3 billion of hours invested in collective singing in the EU. So we're not even talking about the bigger Europe here. It's only in the European Union. Now, if we look at the professional side, so we can say it's a participatory business model, and the participants, the singers, are investing their free time, but they are also investing money. They're investing money to pay the organization of the choir, to pay the employment of the conductor, and sometimes also of voice trainers, soloists, instrumentalists, as we saw tonight, the instrumentalists that are accompanying a choir like that, they are not amateurs. They are usually professionals, and they need to be paid, and somebody has to pay for that. So if we look at the conductor's situation, if we assume there are about 600,000 choirs in the EU, that means about 200,000 conductors, because most conductors actually conduct more than one choir. And then our statistics say that 40% are always paid, 58% are at least always paid for rehearsals, but not always for concerts. 10% are only paid for rehearsals, and 30% are never paid. So if we make our calculations again, we come to 120,000 Europeans are getting their income from collective singing. So collective singing is also contributing to creating jobs. I have to finish here. I could talk more, but it will take too much time. Just to say, this research was a pilot research. It was a first step. However, we think that it already proved its usefulness for the choral sector and for the cultural sector at large. We had a chance to disseminate it widely online in paper form and during conferences and events. And we hope that it can also contribute to a new attitude towards statistical approaches in the cultural sector, and I will maybe talk a bit about that with Barbara Gessler, to encourage other networks to also dare to produce their own statistics and use them to better answer certain questions, and why not, to anticipate the needs and the expectations of the European citizens. We believe, however, that the value of this study goes far beyond the statistical figures themselves. So we have learned the size of our potential market, how many people we are potentially representing as a European network, and that was very interesting for us. And as I said, we also learned what are the main beliefs and aims and wishes of the people that we are working for. So, yes, I have come to this part, the end of this part of the presentation. If you want to know more about it, you will find flyers and reports. And of course, we have some people with badges walking around in the room. You can ask all of them. They are our board members, staff members, and they will be happy to answer more questions. But now, after this rather theoretical presentation with all those figures and statistics, we want to become more practical, and we want to see if you can be the voice of Europe this evening. And I think you already read the threat in the invitation that you may be forced to sing tonight. So I invite our Vice President, Carlo Pavese, on stage to teach us all together a song.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm happy to hear that you have been singing in the last 12 months. So now we will sing together a little more. So for the next 12 months, you can still raise your hand. I've chosen a canon of Michael Praetorius, so a German composer, with an Italian text saying, Viva la musica. And for 5 minutes, I will do like with my choir. So I would like to ask you please to stand up. Since we want to be relaxed and enjoy the well-being effect of singing, we can move a little bit our shoulders to let the tension of the day go, and the neck, carefully rotate a little bit. And then we can produce a sound like we are tasting something very good, like. Very good. Can you make it a little higher? Can you make it enjoy the way down too? Very good. So, I've said with my choir, we take a little more time to prepare your voice, but now I think we can go. So the canon goes like this.
Viva, viva la musica. Viva, viva la musica. Viva la musica.
I think you recognize three phrases, and now I sing the first, and you answer to me.
Viva, viva la musica.
Viva, viva la musica.
Viva, viva la musica.
Viva, viva la musica.
Viva la musica.
Viva.
To hear for the first time the voice of your choir. So thank you very much. As you notice, the beginning is a little higher and the last phrase goes down. So you will probably enjoy, if you're a tenor or a soprano, more the first phrase, and if you're a bass or an alto, you enjoy singing the low tones. But we try again, and you need a little bit of energy for the first tone. I sing again for you.
Viva, viva la musica.
Viva, viva la musica.
Viva, viva la musica.
Viva, viva la musica.
Viva la musica.
Viva.
Sing it together from the beginning to the end. It's possible that you don't remember everything, but this really doesn't matter. You just follow your instinct, and I will help you if there are some mistakes. Start from here. Good luck.
Viva, viva la musica. Viva, viva la musica.
A melody that we sing all together but starting in different moments, and in this case it's canon in three voices, three parts canon. So I have to divide you in three groups, and when you are on the line of my arm you decide where you want to be, but this is, let's say, this is the first group. Then we have the middle group, more or less until here. Yes, perfect. And this is the third. Okay, let's hear. Now we hear the harmony, the melody, three melodies create the harmony.
Viva, viva la musica. Viva, viva la musica.
But now we finish together, and when we finished, I don't know if you heard, we heard the harmony suddenly. We could really listen to each other. So I would do it once more, just asking now to listen to the voice of your neighbors, which is one of the main points of singing together in a choir. And we start from this group to be democratic, so first, second, and third. Let's try again.
Germans in the audience, we will try to switch to German for the following conversation. If you don't understand German, there are some headsets at the back, but we want to give the translators from English to German a break and they can translate the other way around. Frau Gessler, erst einmal herzlichen Dank, dass Sie heute Abend gekommen sind. Ich fange mit einer ganz persönlichen Frage an. Sie haben sich gemeldet, als ich gefragt habe, wer sich selber auch als Sängerin oder Sänger bezeichnet. Können Sie uns ein bisschen mehr dazu sagen, warum Sie sich da gemeldet haben?
Ich komme fast jeden Morgen, wenn ich mich gut fühle, singend ins Büro und dann wissen meine Leute schon, dass ich da bin. Ich wurde mal als Kind gefragt, ob ich im Kirchenchor mitsingen möchte. Da hat mich ehrlich gesagt die Regelmäßigkeit des sonntäglichen Kirchengangs dann so später in der Pubertät ein bisschen von abgehalten. Aber ich habe immer gedacht, ich würde gerne singen. Ich habe mal so ein A Cappella-Chor ein bisschen aus Spaß in Berlin mitgemacht. Also ich würde gerne mehr singen, aber aus diversen Gründen tue ich es nicht.
Ja, aber das ist schön. Das heißt, es war für Sie nicht das erste Mal heute Abend, dass Sie in einem gemeinschaftlichen Rahmen gesungen haben. Sprechen wir über die Studie. Wir kennen uns schon sehr lange, aber ich war zuletzt offiziell sozusagen bei Ihnen im Büro 2015, um das erste Exemplar dieser Singing Europe-Studie vorzustellen. Sie waren also wirklich unter den allerersten Leuten, die die Zahlen und die Ergebnisse gesehen haben. Bevor Sie unsere Studie gesehen haben, was war Ihre persönliche Vorstellung von einem Chor oder von der Chorwelt?
Ich muss zugeben, dass das, was Sie gesagt haben von den etwas Grauhaarigeren in der Kirche, schon relativ prägend für mein Bild vom Chor war. Aber natürlich habe ich auch gewusst, dass es nicht realistisch ist. In meiner Familie wird viel gesungen und insofern weiß ich auch, dass Kinder singen. Aber in der Tat, also ich habe da einiges in der Studie gesehen.
Heißt es, dass die Zahlen und vielleicht auch die Bilder und die anderen Antworten in der Studie dazu beigetragen haben, Ihr Bild von dem, was die Chorwelt, das Chorsingen ist, ein bisschen zu verändern?
Absolut. Als ich die Studie das erste Mal gehört und gesehen habe, da bin ich völlig beschwingt aus dem Büro gegangen. Sie erinnern sich daran. Ich war völlig begeistert und es ist wahrscheinlich, geht Ihnen das auch so, wenn man diese Zahlen sieht und wenn man wenn man sieht, was das für eine Bewegung ist, wo jeder dabei ist, wenn wir auch die Bilder gesehen haben von den jungen und alten und mittelalten Leuten, die singen, das ist sowas von einem Begeisterung, das kann so eine Begeisterung auslösen. Und das war so das Erste, was ich gedacht habe. Natürlich war ich sehr, sehr impressed, also beeindruckt von den Zahlen. So wie wahrscheinlich alle hier, wenn man das erste Mal sich vor Augen führt, dann sieht man, wie Völker und Generationen verbinden tatsächlich das Singen ist. Das ist nicht überraschend, das wissen wir wahrscheinlich, aber wenn man es dann schwarz auf weiß sieht und erhoben, wissenschaftlich belegt, dann kriegt es nochmal so eine andere Dimension, finde ich.
Ja, das ist sehr schön. Wir haben diese Reaktion gespürt bei Ihnen und auch bei den Leuten, bei anderen Leuten in der Kommission, bei denen wir das vorgestellt haben. Und wir haben damals als direkte Rückmeldung bekommen, es ist so toll, dass ein Kulturnetzwerk sich mal dran gemacht hat, qualitative und quantitative Zahlen zu sammeln oder Forschungsergebnisse zu sammeln und vorzustellen. Warum ist Datensammlung im Kultursektor aus Ihrer Sicht auch für die Europäische Kommission so wichtig?
Im Kulturbereich ist es immer noch eine sehr große Herausforderung. Es gibt seit sagen wir fast 10 Jahren inzwischen Arbeitsgruppen, die sich mit diesem Thema beschäftigen, dass wir es sehr schwer haben, Zahlen zu finden über generelle Kulturstatistiken, über den Kultur- und Kreativbereich. Und insofern ist so eine Studie natürlich schon relativ wegweisend. Wir haben inzwischen auch andere Projekte, die das tun, die wir auch unterstützen. Sie haben es gesagt, unter Kultur 2000 und unter Kultur 2007 bis 2013 unter Creative Europe versuchen wir immer wieder solche Projekte auch zu unterstützen, aber es bleibt eine Herausforderung, ganz einfach, weil Europa doch immer noch sehr auf unterschiedliche Art und Weisen Statistiken erhebt und deswegen bleibt es bis heute, obwohl man schon so lange darüber redet, auch gerade zwischen den Mitgliedstaaten, eine Herausforderung. Wir haben gerade letztes Jahr wieder eine Sitzung gehabt mit Eurostat, also hier dieser europäischen Institution, die dafür verantwortlich ist, die genau das Thema Kulturstatistiken behandelt und es bleibt in ständiger Entwicklung. Sie haben in Bonn einen Nachbarn auch im Haus der Kultur, der sich seit langem mit dem Thema europäische Kulturstatistik befasst. Es gibt einfach verschiedene Traditionen, verschiedene Bedeutung, die man diesem Thema auch beimisst. Und natürlich, das haben Sie vorhin auch nochmal sehr schön gesagt, es gibt tatsächlich auch so ein bisschen die Angst. Wenn man Zahlen auf den Tisch legt, dann setzt man sich einen Vergleich aus. Ja? Jetzt in dem Fall ist das ein schöner Vergleich, ja? Viele sind wahrscheinlich stolz darauf. Aber häufig sind Zahlen natürlich auch, dann stehen wir genauso gut oder schlechter da. Und deswegen, glaube ich, gibt es so ein bisschen diese Berührungsängste, gerade in so einem Bereich, der politisch gesehen, hier in Brüssel kann man das sagen, subsidiär angeordnet ist. Natürlich nicht unbedingt dieses große sofort Hallo-Schreien, wir wollen alle unsere Daten zusammenbringen und wir wollen sie nach demselben Schema erheben. Ich glaube, das hat viel noch damit zu tun.
Aber ich kann aus unserem Bereich auf jeden Fall auch sagen, dass eine der größten Schwierigkeiten für uns war, als wir uns die nationalen Studien vorgenommen haben, die es durchaus gibt, ist, dass effektiv natürlich auch die Frage, die gestellt wurde, in jedem Land anders war. Und dadurch die Vergleichbarkeit der Statistiken manchmal sehr schwierig ist. Wir mussten da also auch Anmerkungen am Ende machen und sagen, gut, vielleicht haben in einem Land mehr Leute mit Ja geantwortet, weil die Frage offener formuliert war. Wenn es zum Beispiel eben heißt, haben Sie mit anderen zusammen gesungen in den letzten 12 Monaten? Ist schon ein bisschen präziser als die Eurobarometer-Frage, aber ist immer noch sehr offen und kann natürlich auch von Nicht-Chorsängern positiv beantwortet werden. Und dadurch ergeben sich genau diese Schwierigkeiten. Also ich höre heraus, Sie sind immer noch nicht zufrieden mit dem, was da ist an Datensammlung und es wird weiter ein wichtiger Punkt bleiben für den Kultursektor.
Ja, und nicht nur für den Kultursektor. Einige von Ihnen wissen, dass, weil Sie auch dabei waren, in den Arbeitsgruppen, die wir im letzten Jahr die Europäische Kommission aufgelegt hat zum Thema Musik. Gerade für den Bereich Musik ist das Thema Datenerhebung in jeglicher Art noch sehr, sehr wichtig. Sie haben es angedeutet, Kultur und gerade auch Musik ist nicht nur ein kultureller Faktor in Europa, sondern es ist auch ein wesentlicher Wirtschaftsfaktor. Sie haben von den Conductern gesprochen, von den Orchesterleitern, von den Chorleitern etc., von den professionellen Instrumentalisten, die dafür auch Geld bekommen und auch Geld bekommen sollen, wie Sie richtig gesagt haben. Das ist kein Hobby, das ist eine Profession. Aber gerade dieses Bewusstsein auch nochmal zu schärfen dafür, dass gerade auch Musik, Präsident Juncker hat das letztes Jahr in seiner State of the Union Rede nochmal gesagt, Musik ist mehr als ein Hobby, Musik ist auch ein Beruf. Und dass wir dafür sorgen können müssen, dass Menschen, die in diesem Bereich beruflich tätig sind, auch davon leben können, im besten Sinne, nicht immer noch so einen Nebenjob machen müssen, in der Kneipe joggen, ja, zum Beispiel. Dafür brauchen wir Zahlen, dafür müssen wir natürlich zuverlässige Grundlagen haben, wie für jede europäische Politik, aber in diesem Bereich, wie gesagt, weil es so schwierig ist, ist es schwer zu sagen, was brauchen wir eigentlich oder wie sieht es eigentlich wirklich aus. Und deswegen ist es nach wie vor eine Herausforderung für alle Kultur- und Kreativbereiche, aber im Musikbereich, mit dem wir uns jetzt besonders beschäftigen in diesen Jahren, ist es ganz besonders wichtig.
Sie sind ja jetzt verantwortlich für das Programm Kreatives Europa und da gibt es eine eigene Budgetline für Netzwerke, für kulturelle Netzwerke. Sie sehen, manchmal stolpern wir über die deutschen Wörter. Wie sehen Sie die Rolle der Netzwerke in diesem Bereich? Was können die Netzwerke tun? Wie können die Netzwerke da helfen?
Wir fördern Netzwerke. Wir haben inzwischen um die 23 und wie vielleicht einige in dem Raum wissen, haben wir jetzt auch eine Aufforderung zur Einreichung von Vorschlägen gemacht, wo ich auch echt die Daumen drücke, dass es klappt, dass wir ein etwas größeres Netzwerk an Netzwerken haben, die genau dieses machen sollen. Es sind Organisationen, die als Partner der Kommission dazu beitragen können, aus dem Sektor, in dem sie tätig sind, wirklich auch Feedback zu geben über die Situation in ihrem Sektor. Und Daten zum Beispiel gehören dazu. Das soll jedes Netzwerk eigentlich machen können. Nicht jedes kann es, weil andere kommen auch aus einer anderen Tradition, sagen wir mehr so aus dem Lobbying-Bereich oder so weiter. Das ist auch alles absolut korrekt. Aber die Kommission braucht eben, um ihre Politik weiterzuentwickeln, tatsächlich auch solche Erhebungen. Das können diese Netzwerke machen. Die können uns und müssen uns auch natürlich ständig darüber informieren, wie gerade die Entwicklungen in einem bestimmten Bereich sind, in welche Richtung geht es, wo sind die Herausforderungen, wo sind die Chancen. Wenn wir über Musik reden zum Beispiel, geht es ganz stark um das Thema Vertrieb. Wie wird heute Musik vertrieben im wahrsten Sinne? Wo hören wir Musik? Und wie kommen wir an welche Musik? Das sind ganz, ganz große Themen im Augenblick. Playlists und so weiter. Das sind ganz neue Sachen, die vor 10 Jahren, als Creative Europe, Kreatives Europa geschaffen wurde, noch nicht so auf der Agenda standen. Und jetzt werde ich ja mal vorgestellt, als Leiterin von Creative Europe bin ich nicht nur für das Kulturunterprogramm, Teilprogramm, aber natürlich ist das auch das, was uns mit dem Film verbindet, weil auch da Netflix gab es vor 10 Jahren nicht oder hatte zumindest niemand auf der Agenda. Heute kann man sich gar nicht ein Leben ohne Netflix, kann man sich vielleicht noch Leute vorstellen, aber es ist revolutionär, was da gerade passiert und darauf müssen wir reagieren können und dazu brauchen wir die Profis, die uns sagen können, wie ihr Sektor auch gerade von solchen Herausforderungen gerade geprägt ist und wie sie damit umgehen.
Vielen Dank. Eine letzte Frage vielleicht noch. Wir haben jetzt auch über die Sache gesprochen, dass eben gemeinschaftliches Singen auch soziale Effekte hat und dass es helfen kann, Menschen, die in Gefahr sind, ausgeschlossen zu werden, zu integrieren, Inklusion, Integration. Sehen Sie das auch so und ist im Programm Kreatives Europa jetzt das ganze Programm, also schon im Kulturprogramm in Kreatives Europa, auch die Möglichkeit, solche Dinge zu fördern, ist das auch eines der Ziele vom Programm?
Ja, wir kennen uns lange und wir hatten diese Diskussion schon in früheren Jahren. Es ist wieder wichtiger geworden und in der Tat hat sich ja auch, wie Herr von Heusiger auch in seinem Eingangsstatement gesagt hat, die Welt ändert sich ja auch gerade ein bisschen. Und so Themen wie die Flüchtlingsbewegungen, die wir in den letzten Jahren erlebt haben, die neuen Kulturkreise, die zu uns kommen, mit denen wir uns verstehen müssen und die wir aber auch wollen, dass sie uns verstehen. Das sind ganz neue gesellschaftliche Herausforderungen. mit denen wir jetzt umgehen können, die vielleicht auch wieder so ein bisschen die Blickrichtung in diese Richtung gelenkt haben, dass man sagt, so interkultureller Dialog und so weiter spielen heute vielleicht wieder eine wichtigere Rolle als vielleicht vor 10 Jahren. Das nimmt nicht diese andere Bedeutung weg, des Ökonomischen auch. Also wir reden ja in Europa auch über Wachstum und Beschäftigung. Das bleiben wichtige Themen auch für die Kommission natürlich. Aber das andere hat wieder an Bedeutung gewonnen, weil die Gesellschaft sich so geändert hat in den letzten Jahren. Und gerade Musik, und ich sage jetzt ausdrücklich nicht nur gemeinsames Singen, aber gerade Musik ist natürlich ein hervorragendes Instrument, solche inklusiven Tätigkeiten, wenn man so will, wo es keine Grenzen gibt beim Singen. Ja? Also es ist ja nochmal was anderes, wenn ich über Oper rede beispielsweise. Da wissen wir, dass es so Leute gibt, die Angst haben davor, in die Oper zu gehen, weil sie sagen, werde ich das verstehen, kann ich das, bin ich da richtig angezogen, das ist vielleicht auch manchmal sehr teuer oder so. Aber Singen an sich braucht jeder eigentlich nur sich selber und er muss den Mumm haben, den Mund aufzumachen und zu singen. Aber mehr braucht es eigentlich nicht. Also wir haben keine großen Zugangshürden. Und deswegen ist, glaube ich, Singen nochmal besonders auch in diesem Musikbereich.
Vielen Dank. Wir könnten uns noch lange weiter unterhalten, aber ich glaube, der Chor steht vor der Tür und möchte uns noch zum Abschluss dieses Abends nochmal eine ganz andere Art von Musik präsentieren, damit wir ein bisschen was von der Bandbreite an Chorrepertoire zu sehen haben. Herzlichen Dank.
Part, we offer you some popping part. If you want to join, you can snap your fingers, sing, whatever. Because now I know you are all warmed up with your voices.
Oh,
that?
Yeah.
Only one condition, you sing with us?
Yeah.
Yes. Experienced singers, so listen to the second voice, they will teach you the melody. It's not difficult. Dommage. No, you can do a remain seated. Okay, listen carefully. I think you know the song, but the tricky part is that you have to use your body. Your turn. It sounds quite in tune, though. Ready? So, you heard some beatboxing. This is Stain. Can you montrer un petit peu?
Thank you much for being here and have a nice evening. Thank you.